Good morning, everybody, or good day. Depends on when you woke up. So yesterday we started with presentations on why we should archive geodata and what is important to archive. And today we're starting with the part where we're talking about solutions. And one of the solutions is also the things we have produced in the eArk project, and we are continuing to develop in the eArk for All, and which is, as you know, now a building block of the European Commission called the eArchiving building block. So in my presentation today, I will go shortly what we did in the eArk project regarding the geodata. Then I will talk more extensively about the specifications on what to archive and how to package it together so that we can have a comprehensive package of geodata that is used in the future. And I will then also shortly touch on the tools we tested and sample tools that are available for archiving. If you're also wanting to learn more about it, we can offer some training and consultancy, and we also want to engage you as the producers and the archivists to see what you need in order to make these specifications fitted to your needs. So the eArk project started in 2014. I joined in 2015, and my part was to facilitate the pilot of archiving geospatial data and to package it in a proper way and to create specifications using the tools that were developed in the eArk and existing tools for GIS. So we have some specifications on how to package the data, that it can be applied to SIPs, AIPs, and DIPs. And we have fully tested the eArk tools and the open source tools that I will demonstrate. And you also saw how open source tools can be used in the presentation by IGEA. And the result were two pilots where we did the acquisitions of Natura 2000 in the Slovenian Environmental Agency, which will be presented after the break. And we also used the old borders of municipalities to integrate with the different acquisition of digital data, which was the polling results for Slovenian independence. And this in the bottom is the result. So how we created a thematic map out of two records that were archived from different time periods. Because you cannot display data if you don't have the maps from that area, from that time frame. So it just doesn't fit. Okay, so this is a mouthful. Geodata content information type specification, shortly GeoCITS. So what are the content type specifications and what are the archival package specifications? So in order to have packages packaged in a way that we can all understand them in this unified digital world of the European Union, this is what the building blocks are promoting. So if we want to package them in a way that we can understand them and equally use them all around Europe, then we need to have some guidelines. And these guidelines are the specifications for archival packages. These common specifications are something that we are developing and will be implemented in the future time, because currently the solutions that already exist would need to adopt them and become interoperable between each other. But this is not the case yet, because we know when you have a solution that's working, to do some major revolutionized changes, it takes time. But what we can use right now is the package, the content specification. So if we have content type, for instance, we defined the content types for databases, for document management systems, for geodata as well, and in the future we're also going to do work with medical data and so on. We also saw yesterday some experiences with archival, archaeological data. They also have their own content type because they have different type of information. So that's why we developed within this eArk for All program the geo content information type specification, so geocits. And I would kindly invite you to go to this short bit.ly link, which will be presented all through this presentation, so that you can download the PDF, check it out, give us some comments. If you find it's too specific, not specific enough, if you understand everything or not, so that you can see how this will be applied. But now, to tell you what it all encompasses, we also need to go to the habitat of geodata. Where does geodata live? So geodata lives in a GIS system. Yesterday we spoke about different formats of geodata, and how does it happen that geodata goes from its original form, database, raster data, vector data, maybe some additional tables, models, to the screen of an information product to the user. It's not just the data that we need to archive. We also need to archive how the GIS tools were used to organize it, to query it, to do the cartographic projections of the data, to transform the data. Currently in Slovenia, there's a project of changing of the coordinate system. So all these transformations are very, very important if we want to use the old data accordingly. So we need to store the transformation parameters and tools that were used should be modeled in order to be replicated in the future. And I think that FME that was presented right now could be a good solution for that, because we can automate it, we just put in the parameters. Second thing is, we need to store the symbology that was used, the geoprocessing, what kind of products were created, what kind of lists, what kind of maps, and so on. And this all produces some results in the end, and these results are then displayed on the screen of the user. So we are not just storing geodata, and the question that you had yesterday from City of Ljubljana was on point. The formats are not the big picture, no. That was just a small thing, but today we're talking about the big picture. So to go beyond just the data, to go to archiving GIS systems, because we will not archive software. In 20 years, I mean, if you look back 20 years or even 30 years, we had Unix systems with terminals, and the GIS was on a Unix machine. Today, you can't even find some people who could use it. I mean, even if it worked, okay? So we need to start thinking about how to reproduce these complex formulas. For instance, if we want a result on, let's say, appropriate use of land, or to find the closest facilities for some purpose, we often use very complex geoprocessing workflows. And if they are documented well enough, then we can use tools of the future, or currently we can use the FME or whatever it will be in 20 years, to replicate this. Because our idea as archivists are that we take the data from the existing systems so that we can reproduce the information products in the future. And data and information products is not the same thing. So data is something that we use to produce an information product. It's not always stored in the same way and done as quickly as it should be in the original system, but sometimes in the archives you can wait a week or two so you can manually create a replication of this information product if you know how. But as I said yesterday, let's get things even more complicated. So for instance, in Slovenia today, if you want to build a house, you need a building permit. In order to get the building permit, you need to have clearance from different geodata records. So, Ministry of Culture has a record set of cultural heritage areas where you cannot build. Ministry of Defense has its own areas where you cannot build. Then you have the Environmental Agency, who has its own many records where you cannot build. Then you have a Ministry of Urban, it's not the Ministry of, yeah, it's Ministry of Environment, which has a state urban plans, and the municipality has their own urban plans, and then you have to intersect that as well. And this is all lying in various systems that are changing independently. So if we as archivists would like to replicate this document in the future, we need to know how to get to the time slot required to replicate this specific document, which is not a problem. I mean, why do we need this kind of documents? Because we also archive things for our legal protection. And if there's something very wrong with, I don't know, some factory who sues the government because it didn't give the permission or did give the permission, we need to know how to replicate the decision to see what went wrong so that we can prevent it in the future or to prevent the lawsuit from going through. Okay, so this is to complicate things a little bit, but as Mr. Radovan said yesterday, let's start small because we don't have answers to all the questions, but we have answers to some simple questions. So what should an archival package contain? Well, here I will tell you a story. When I went to a friend of mine who works in a utility company, he told me that he likes old things, old gadgets, and he wanted to rebuild an old phone. This is a very famous phone done by Iskra in the 80s, and it got a lot of awards and so on. So this is the package that he wanted to make usable again. It was broken, something was not working, some electricity stuff went wrong, because he's an electric technician, I'm not. But to know more about it, what he did was he checked the package, the labeling, the description. So on the bottom of the telephone, he had information about the telephone. So this is some kind of metadata. So these are the general metadata that we have, and this is the thing that we need in our common specification. We need to know something about the package. Then when we open the package, we see, okay, there are some technical stuff, some electrical boards and so on. How does this work? Well, obviously people in Iskra were archivists because they included the technical documentation. So I was thinking, yeah, that's the way we should have it. So we should have a package where we have a technical documentation so that we can then open it up and analyze how things were working or were supposed to work, and then, okay, excellent. We can reproduce it. We can even recreate this motherboard if the motherboard was broken, and so on. So this is the thing that we want to tell you about packages for geodata. What do we need inside those packages to understand them? So the first thing is we need the data. And the second thing, we need context, we need documentation and metadata for reading with the machine-readable languages and so on. So these are the main three areas that I'm going to go through. So the first thing is, as I spoke yesterday, we need to have a long-term preservation formats for this data. And as Mr. João Masso said, we need the possibility to have the golden copy, the original. Then we also need to have some technical information on how this data was used to properly represent it in the future. I specifically targeted the coordinate system information because this is something that is often forgotten, especially in small countries because we don't have many different coordinate system areas. But already in Austria and Croatia, they have three regions and they need to know which coordinate system fits together so that it works. And again, this is the link, which is bit.ly geo CITS. Go there and you will see the specifications. So this is how the package should look like. We already tested this in the project of Slovenian National Electronic Archiving and with the pilot project we did on eArk. So when we were packaging the data from Natura 2000, we used this format and this structure so that we could actually package all the information inside. And it's then easy to use and reuse. Okay, what we used for long-term preservation formats. For geodata, we decided, okay, currently we know GeoTIFF and TIFF with additional metadata, which could be metadata. We're not very strict right now because these are the guidelines and we know that everybody doesn't have things ordered out. So I will talk more about metadata later on. Then for the vector data, we decided we would say that the long-term preservation format is GML 3.2.1. My choice for that is because the 3.1 version does not include the coordinate system information, which is very important for us to know. So you need to have it beside that. And of course, if data is in database formats, we can export it to CVS or CArt, which is also a product that was developed in eArk after the Swiss National Archives said that we can make the version 2.0 and tools for that. And in the next eArk 3 project, we're going to upgrade the CArt tool to enable export of GML files. This is the idea that we're proposing. Okay, so these are the long-term preservation formats. Now let's check how we can use that. So when we have a geodata, we can have multiple representations of the same data. Now this causes some redundancy, but it also gives us a little bit of flexibility because we can have the original and we have the long-term preservation format, so we have a sort of backup that when we create a DIP, we can offer the golden copy if it's still readable, but if it passes, I don't know, 20, 30 years, then we can have a long-term preservation format which is definitely there. So this is where I see also the use of tools like FME could be very useful so that, for instance, when the GML format is outdated, we can just say, okay, we have the whole repository, I don't know, petabytes of GMLs, but we need to have this converted in a documented and a reliable fashion. And this is where such a server could be very handy. Again, the URL is bit.li/geocits. You will remember it until the end, believe me. okay, so the next thing is coordinate system definitions. So we have coordinate systems that are defined in different ways. In Slovenia, we have a special case because we had different software types in the beginning, and because we did not have a Slovenian coordinate system defined as we wanted, we just created our own specifications. So we have slow GK 48 and whatever, and this is something non-standard. So what we propose is that when we are exporting data to archives, we define these coordinate systems according to the EPGS format, because they have a catalog of all coordinate systems, although there might be some that are missing, so that's where we want to have another discussion on how to solve this. This is something that we don't know yet. But we can use this EPSG also because GeoTIFF only supports the EPSG coordinate systems. So that's its limitation. So in order to show you, this is how the coordinate system looks like in the GML format. It's defined by the EPSG code. And then softwares like QGIS can understand it and display it properly. But there's a backup. You can also use a text file with the .prj for shapefiles or for rasters and so on. So there are many, many options that we are also describing within the specification. Okay, so when we're finished with the geodata, now we need technical documentation. What is technical documentation? It is something that we need to have in order to understand the data. Because if we open a shapefile, and there's a couple of lines, and then we open the table, and in the table we get some geoglyph ID, and then we have some area and some numbers. We don't know which, is it square meters, is it square miles, whatever it is. So we need to have technical documentation about the data to understand it. One of it is attribute definitions. So we need to have attributes defined. Now, if it's in a XML fashion in a metadata form, it's best, but we are also satisfied if we get a Word file with this documented or some screenshots from the software, whatever happens, so that we can use it faster and so we can package it faster. The next thing is feature catalogs. to know what types of attributes we can expect or what are errors. Then we have the logical structure. If we have a larger GIS system, we need to know how the tables are connected between each other, how data sets are connected, how they were stored in a project, so that we can recreate the project. When I worked for City of Ljubljana, we saw that they have more than 500 layers in their GIS project, which is, if you want to replicate that system, you have to have this documented. Now, luckily, ArcGIS has a good tool to export this to an XML file, so we can document that over there. Then we need to store the cartography, the visualization, so that we know what certain colors meant and how they were used. So my question here is, in what format do we do that so that it is machine readable? So I know that there are SLT formats, but they are only for web services. So we cannot always replicate the complete cartography, but with some documentation, we can then try to do it as best as we can. We also need common queries, how things were used, what kind of exports were there. Was it just in a web page, or was it an export, was it a map? And of course, what geoprocessing workflows were there, so that then we can use the tools like FME to recreate that in the future without needing to set up the whole GIS system that was used in the producer's location. So this is a technical documentation. Now, more about the historical information and the context. This is something where you also need to relate the information to other bodies of knowledge, like how to archive the knowledge about coordinate systems, about GIS, about such things, because all data needs context. Let me show you an example. This is an aerial image of a Slovenian hilly area where there are a lot of hills. And this aerial image is a bit older, so when it was created, they had rather poor digital inputs for orthophotos, which means that the positional accuracy of this orthophoto is 6 meters. And then we see that the road in the cadastre is 36.7 meters away from the road on the image. So which data is correct now? None of it. It's all somewhere. But if we don't know the context, if we don't know the history behind that, we also can't interpret the data in the future. So that's why you also need information about the context, about what things were going on. So it's much wider than just storing geodata. It's also storing the stories behind it and how things happened. And to do that, we would recommend that you store the project documentation, pointers to the legal backgrounds, lineage, the methodology, and interviews. Maybe even make interviews with people who worked at the time. Now, why is lineage important? The methodology of how the data was created. For instance, if we have an example of 1 meter, if vector data was digitized from a 1 to 50,000 map, then 1 millimeter error on the map equals to 50 meter errors in nature. But if this same road was mapped by GPS, we only have a 2 to 5 meter error or accuracy. So if we have this information, we know about the accuracy of the data as well. But there is also other accuracies, not just positional. We also have temporal accuracies. For instance, this is a catalog of Slovenian topographic maps according to the year in which they were recreated. So this means that, let's say, the violet number is between 2013 and the light yellow is in the year 2002. So there's a... You see it here, the violet and the yellow ones. These two maps were created more than 10 years apart. So you can imagine the accuracy and the context in which to understand these maps. Okay, so these are the things that we describe that we need to think about, and how to do it is depending on, are we archiving an old system, or are we going to design the new system in a way that's supporting archiving. Now let's go to metadata. We spoke about metadata yesterday, also about Inspire directive, why it is important. And here I think it's important that we say that we use the Inspire directive to catalog the 22 necessary elements in the archival metadata, which can be then transported into the archival metadata system. Either it can be EAD or ESAG. So we had these translation tables created. But still, there are some elements that we would need to extend the archival system to include, like lineage and accuracy. So we also require the storage of geodata metadata, because we will then use it in geodata applications. If it's already there, why not? But if you don't have anything, so if you don't have the ISO standard or national standard or Inspire metadata, you might have a project in PDF or in paper where this metadata is described, and some researcher in 20 or 50 years can then dig in and find the information needed to recreate the information. But in the end, we also need to describe everything using the archival metadata. So that's why we suggested the elements based on Inspire. You can increase this if you find the elements within the EAD or ESAG. And that makes it easy for us to harvest existing metadata from GIS systems into the archival catalog system. So in the specifications, which you can get on bit.ly/geocits, we also proposed the number of elements, where you can see that the numbers from Inspire are actually mentioned. And then we have the ESAG code. And in the next version, we will also add the EAD code so that we know how to actually transform it. And again, I think that the FME tool can be very instrumental in using these translations. So what's next? In these specifications, we did the first step. We told you how to archive elements from simple records, like one-layer records and so on. But we need to define how to archive the whole GIS systems and multiple GIS systems in the future. We need to know how to archive geo workflows and transformations. This is where we would probably need to turn to the geospatial community, not so much the archival, but we need to start talking. And we also need to know how to storage symbology, the visualization of things, just to begin with. And I believe that some other questions will arise in the future. So here we need your input. And to get the input, go to the bit.ly/geocits and download the PDF. Give us comments so that you can then get better specifications. Okay. So now something about how we should implement the specifications, what we can do with it already. Well, the first thing is we need to separate two different situations, two different scenarios. The first scenario is archiving of existing systems, because we will not develop tools in the existing or obsolete systems. We take what we get, because nobody will put a lot of effort and resources to changing things for us, archivists. And the other thing is proactive preservation in new and existing systems that are still developing. So to go and cover the first scenario, we need to firstly identify which data is archival and start with the base maps, start with the surveying and mapping authorities in your countries if you're the archivists, and then you will know with other producers which data is already stored in the base map location. And then when you do that, gather this information, convert it to long-term preservation format, and gather documentation. But the next thing is more interesting, which is how to put the archival step into the life cycle of the data. This is why we don't have data archiving committee. We have Dilsi's board with this, which is more inclined to this topic of life cycle support. So before you, when you're designing new systems, it's just a data hygiene that you take care of backup before you put things into distribution. Because in this way, we can have 20 different GIS systems that can be then recreated for the certain moment in time. So if we have the delta elements here, or we have backups that we can go to the certain point in time, then we can save the data and also prevent us from losing the information in a certain area. So this is about how to implement the things, and now to the tools. So when we're using tools in the eArk process, if you want to have your own archive and you're not already having a system, there are possibilities of using already created sample tools like Roda In and Roda by Kips. It's a Portuguese company. It's an open source model, so you can get the software freely, but if you want to set it up, you might need some help. It's the same with the Swedish solution by ESSR. And there's also a tool for exporting data from existing system, which is a competition to FME, I guess. But it's actually designed for archives to export from databases to a CIRT format. What we also did was test the usage of open source GIS tools. Where we see the benefits are that these tools are openly available, and OGR to OGR is a library that can export data from or convert data to different formats, to long-term preservation format. We can use the ingest to make proof of concept. We can make a test DIP with a QGIS to see if we can actually reproduce the system in the archives. Then, as was mentioned today, GeoNetwork is a very good existing metadata catalog for geodata. Why would we need to extend the existing catalog of archives if we can already have a made geo catalog archive and we can just connect those two? So this is the faster way to actually connect this. And when I was working in Slovenian National Archives, we implemented this solution with GeoNetwork in the project that is now currently being developed. And of course, GeoServer and QGIS can be then used to serve the data for our users as a WMS services, WFS services, whatever. Okay. Now I promised to tell something about training and consulting. So for archivists, we can offer trainings on introduction to geospatial records, more than I said today. We can offer trainings on how to implement the GeoCITS specifications and basics about coordinate systems. And we are also developing tools on how to use the OGC tools for archiving and appraising geospatial records. And for producers, we can have the courses on introduction to archiving principles, adding archiving data flow practices to their existing systems, and we can offer to do the pilot implementations of the e-archiving building block. And of course, we can help the solution providers to understand the archiving world, like we did for this conference, so that you can know what to offer to the archives, which is now becoming a new niche in the GIS market. So to finish everything, how can you contribute? We need your input, we need your help, because we can't do everything by ourselves. We are organizing a geo subgroup within the DLM forum. If you are an archive or if you are a geodata producer interested in archiving things, I would like kindly ask you to join the geo subgroup. We have a next DLM meeting in Bern, Switzerland next week. In 2 weeks. You can also come and be a This Is Board contributor, where you can help us extend and make the specifications for geodata better, which you can find on bit.ly/geocits. Now you must have remembered, because I'm at the end of my presentation. Or you can present your own solutions, because colleague from Spain said yesterday, things are changing, and if you have better inputs, we can all together make a better specification for archiving geodata. So this is all from my side. I thank you for your attention, and if there's any questions.
Thank you, Gregor. And it's been very nice to see you unveil all the components of the eArk preparation program of the geodata. I hope that there are enough geoproducers in the room so that they know how to prepare the data just before it will become archived. We have already learned a little bit about this yesterday, how we can use standards for packaging it as well. I'm also very interested in these programs that you presented, but maybe there are some movies online or tutorials that explain briefly how this Rodin works, but
There are some videos.
We are running a little bit out of time. We still have a coffee break until at 11 o'clock we have to continue.
Okay.
So I don't know if there are really urgent questions. But otherwise, I would like you to. Maybe one question, yes. Although I'm not authorized to allow you questions, but this is a kind of core part of the conference. Sorry, you may kill me afterwards. Yes? So, is there one short question? I mean, just put it in.
Thank you for your presentation. I wanted to make the joke of asking the URL of the thing, but I will not because we don't have time. My question is, you describe the package as a collection of elements. Are you using a language to actually document the package and all the elements that are there somehow? Do you remember that yesterday in my presentation I was proposing a way of documenting that in the 115 extension? Tell me.
Well, because there are different archival systems, for instance, in Slovenian National Archive, the scope system from Switzerland is being used, which has its own way to describe this package. And within the eArk project, we have the common specifications where we use the three standards for archival metadata, which is METS, PREMIS, and EAD. So there are different ways to describe this, and these METS EAD packages are actually described on the top level, but as I already mentioned, it's not possible to implement it in every system yet, but this is taken care of.